This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. My guest on today's show is my longtime friend, Art Wiederman. We're going to talk about keys to achieving financial independence. Art is a CPA, a financial planner, and he's also one of the co-founders of the Academy of Dental CPAs, the ADCPA. The Academy of Dental CPAs are a group of accounting firms around the country that work either exclusively with dental practices or the majority of the work that they do is with dental practices. And Art was one of the co-founders in 2001 of the Academy of Dental CPAs. You're really going to enjoy Art's discussion about keys to achieving financial independence. This topic is a passion of mine. Sadly, the American Dental Association tells us that in 2017, the most recent year we have information, only 3% of the dentists in the United States could retire at age 65 and not reduce their lifestyle. One of my missions is to change that statistic. You deserve better than that, doctors. And in this episode, Art's going to share some really great tips to help you be in that 3%. Hopefully that becomes a higher percentage, of course, but be in that group of dentists that is able to achieve financial independence. And the reason why that's so important is I want you to be able to go to work because you want to, not because you have to. Hey, you're really going to enjoy this interview with Art. Before I get to that interview, though, we have another Let's Ask David segment. And David, of course, is my longtime friend, Dr. David Hornbrook. In this Let's Ask David segment, he talks about some great tips to improve the quality of the photos that you take in your office for patient education. David is not only a master clinician, but he's a master photographer as well. You'll enjoy his tips on how to improve the quality of your photos for patient education. Here's that Let's Ask David segment. Dr. Hornbrook, you've inspired me to improve the quality of my photos. Can you give me some practical photography tips that I can use? In particular, I'm wanting to take a series of photos with all of our new patients. And I want to make sure that they're high enough quality so that I can see what I need to see, but also be able to communicate these photos with the patients.
Yeah. You know, the one thing we have a saying in the industry is the dentists that take photos do dentistry. And, you know, when they're taking photos and patient is aware of that and you show the patient their teeth in a photograph, whether it be an actual photograph or whether it be on your computer screen as you transfer that over, you know, they realize what needs to be done and what they want done. So first thing is you need to take photos. I mean, as a legal record as well as an educational. I mentioned in a previous episode that we did when we talked about new patient exam is, you know, I'm very visual and I think the patients are as well. And if they can see their smile versus just me telling them or trying to hold a little mirror and they're holding a big mirror, it just doesn't work. So, you know, I think every new patient should have photos. And the ones I'd recommend is certainly a full face. I would also not take that full face in the dental chair where you've got the plastic baggie over the headrest. I mean, it doesn't have to be a photo room. A lot of offices, my office isn't huge, and so we just went to Aaron Brothers Art Marts, and I bought a 24 by 36 inch canvas and just painted it with some blue. And so it's just kind of this cool multicolored background. Just take a full-face photo. And the importance of that is you never know when you're going to use that. I mean, all of a sudden, you do a nice case on that patient, and now you've got this nice before and after with a nice background, not the 12 o'clock unit, you know, behind the patient's chair and patient's head. So I would do full face. I would do full smile. I would do left and right full smiles. And I would use a 1-to-2 as far as ratio. And there's lots of websites. Or the AACD, which we talked in a previous episode, is a great resource. You can go online and see what those photos, those recommended photos. And I would take a retracted view and occlusal views. Now, if your dental assistant or auxiliary are taking that, they're going to have to do some practicing. But, you know, it's real easy to take those once you get used to it. So just to refresh, I would take a full face. I'm going to add a profile, what I call a chin to eyebrow shot. So you can see if these teeth are deflective or reflective. As the patient says, you know, my teeth look yellow. Deflective surfaces always look darker. My teeth look short. Deflective surfaces always look short. And as you talk about, we can correct that by just uprighting your teeth a little bit. Especially if they had ortho as a teenager and the orthodontist had to bring everything back to close spaces that they created. I mean, that's an important shot. So full face, chin to eyebrow of a profile. Full smile, both a frontal view and left and right, because lots of times patient doesn't really see how crooked their teeth are, or maybe a premolar that has an amalgam that looks black, and until you see that lateral view, and then a retracted and both occlusals, and I just think that's more powerful. Is if the patient needs some dentistry to put that up on the screen and say, Gary, you can see that, you know, you've got an old amalgam here, a silver mercury filling that is broken down, and you know, they see that visually, and it's blown up 20 times bigger than the extra tooth. They say, oh my God, I'm screwed up. You know, when they see that visually, they're more apt to accept treatment plan when you say, yeah, you know, it's, I'm not going to say screwed up, but you need to address that, and that's the reason why. So I would absolutely take those, and you can archive those if you wanted to refresh. If it, you know, we've all been in situations where we think we've charted everything or we've written everything down, and it's like, I'm not sure why I recommended a crown on tooth number 15. You know, you can go back to that and say, oh yeah, because it's got that big old composite that doesn't look bad on the radiograph, but it needs to be done based on a clinical exam and the photo. As far as cameras, again, I would absolutely tell people to get a 35 mil, an SLR camera, the body. The digital, they're getting more affordable. I would say get a 100 millimeter lens, a macro lens. And this is where there's some variation. If you're taking a lot of cosmetic photos, the purists would say to get a double point flash. It'll give you more shadows. It gives you more true color. Not so much color, but it'll eliminate shadowing. It'll give you more three-dimensionality. If you're doing it just for your new patient exams and you just want a before and after of all these patients, I would say a ring flash. And I say that because you can't screw up with a ring flash. A double point flash, if I had the points and they can be angled, if I had them a little different angle between pre-op and the after, the before and the after, it's going to look a little different. Now I'm going to put it on my website and it looks different. Where the ring flash will never screw up. And you can still get unbelievable photos with a ring flash. Also, if you're auxiliary, especially if you have multiple auxiliaries that are taking your photos, a ring flash is going to give you more consistency and less standard deviation. But that's a great question. Take photos, because you're going to do more dentistry. Take good photos. I also say that on the lab side. Working in the laboratory, the last thing a ceramist wants to see is an iPhone photo from across the room or a Polaroid that is out of focus. You're basically sending a message to your ceramist that, hey, you know, I'm okay with mediocrity, so you can be too when you send me this crown back. I mean, send good photos. Lab communication, patient communication.
Hey, David, I'll complicate it just a little bit. would you have a recommendation on a simpler camera if any of our listeners are looking at kind of getting started with taking these photos?
Well, there are some. There's the Shofu camera, and I'm not that familiar with them. You know, the Dental Eye has one, the Shofu, you know, you could look online, you know, on dental camera setups. There's different camera setups. There's actually even a setup for an iPhone that uses a macro. I'm not as familiar with it. I just think it's hard to get consistency and reliability. I'm not going to say it can't be done because I've seen them. There's a ceramist in the lab, Phil Niebecker, that does unbelievable photos with his iPhone. But again, it's a high-resolution iPhone. It's not, you know, the iPhone 5 or the 6. I just think for consistency and how we're doing this digital marketing, it just makes sense to post good photos, especially when people are seeing good photos. I mean, look at all the great photos on Instagram and Facebook. I mean, they're gorgeous, whether it be the ceramics on the benchtop or the BD before.
The resolution's amazing.
They're gorgeous. And if all of a sudden the ones from Gary Takas, DDS's office, looks like they took an iPhone photo, it's sending a little bit of a message. So I appreciate that last part of your question. I think that if someone did not want to buy an SLR and they said, you know, I want to go a cheaper route or an easier route, do your research, because that's something that's changing all the time.
Okay. Awesome. Thanks, David. Well, I mentioned in the intro that my guest on today's show is my friend, colleague, and fellow podcaster, Art Wiederman. Hey, Art, how are you?
I'm doing great, Gary. How are you doing today?
Man, I am doing fantastic. And we're going to talk about a topic. Why don't we just knock the top off it right now? We're going to talk about a topic that is of keen interest to every one of our listeners. And the topic is keys to financial independence. And Art, I'm just going to brag on you for just a minute. Would that be okay if I did that?
I have no problem with that, Gary.
I could not think of a better authority to bring on the show to talk about keys to financial independence. Art is a CPA, one of my dear friends, and has been for many, many, many years. We've known each other. We've known each other for almost 30 years, Art. I was thinking about that the other day. It goes back to your days at Pride and back in the late 80s.
That's right. I started my career at Pride. It was the Pacific Institute back then. That's with right. Jim Pride and Phil Whitener. And that's where we met.
Yeah. And it's been a wonderful friendship a professional relationship ever since. And if anyone's thinking, hey, a CPA on a podcast, you know, that can't be very interesting. Let me just tell you right now that Art has the unique ability to take financial topics and actually make them incredibly interesting. Is it okay if I characterize you that way, Art?
Well, you just put a lot of pressure on me, Gary, but I guess I'm going to have to step up to the plate and do that.
Hey, Art, I imagine that some of our listeners will know who you are. We do have listeners in 174 countries, so many will not know who you are. Would you be kind enough to give a little bit of your background? We don't have to go back to when you were a gleam in your father's eyes, but would you share a little bit of your background with our listeners?
Sure. I started after I graduated college, I went to the national CPA firm of Deloitte, Haskins & Sells, decided that was not my career path. And then my best friend, who was a headhunter, said, hey, listen, I've got a job opportunity to run the financial services division of the Pacific Institute of Management. And I said, what is that? And this is a dental management company, a financial management for dentists. So I took the job because I wanted to go a different route. And I started out in 1984 with, I think, 1.5 employees, we call it. And we built the business, and I started lecturing around the country with the late Dr. Jim Pride, who was one of my inspirations, and Dr. Phil Whitener. And the both of us, we started going around the country and lecturing, and we built our business. And fast forward to 1989, I kind of liked the product so much, like Victor Kiam and the Remington Shaver, I bought the company. And in 1989, it became Wiederman and Associates, ran it as a dental CPA firm for many years. And in 2014, my dear, dear friend, Pamela Chamberlain, became my partner, and it became Wiederman and Chamberlain. And last year, I merged my CPA firm with a larger firm here in Tustin, California, which is in Orange County, about 15 minutes from Disneyland. And now I'm a partner and run the dental division at HMWC CPAs and business advisors. So we work with about 250 to 300 dentists in our group. We do taxes, accounting, financial planning, marriage counseling, therapy, whatever we have to do, that's what we do.
Wonderful. Thanks for that background. I want to add to it a little bit, if I could, and that is that you were one of the individuals that was instrumental in founding the ADCPA. They're a group that I am very passionate about. Would you talk a little bit about the ADCPA?
I'd be glad to, Gary. I got a phone call from my friend Ken Rubin in San Diego, who's also a dental CPA, and right around September of 2001. And he said, you know, Art, we're all going to meet. There's a bunch of us are going to meet in Phoenix, and we're going to talk about forming a group of CPAs that work only with dentists. And I said, well, I got nothing better to do that day. So I flew to Phoenix, and 9 of us in a room, 9 dental-specific CPAs, we got together, and we basically formed the Academy of Dental CPAs. And The group has evolved over 18 years. Our president is Alan Schiff in Baltimore, Maryland. We're 24 CPA firms across the United States that represent over 9,000 dentists. And I'll tell you, you know, you get 24 CPAs in a room and it's like, we're going to fall asleep. We're going to watch paint dry. These are fun, engaging people. They made me be in charge of their talent show one year. That was frightening, but we're at the cutting edge. We're talking to all people like you and all the people in dentistry, and these men and women know the numbers of a dental practice and know about financial management and tax law for dentists like no other group that I've ever met. And they are just amazing, amazing people. And I am honored and humbled to be a member of the Academy of Dental CPAs and to be part of this group. These are just some of the finest people I've ever met, and they care more about clients than anything and their financial well-being.
And our listeners may recall that I had one of your members, one of the principals of your member firm, Robbie Apple, on last year to talk about the Tax Act and the changes and how they affect dentists. And Robbie did an amazing job. He's an example of the bright talent that you have as members in the ADCPA.
I'll give you an example. What amazing people they are. When Robbie and his group came to our first meeting, we were kind of vetting to see if they were going to be a member of the group. So Alan, our president, said, "Art, would you talk to them and see if they're, you know, a good group of guys to be in the group?" And I said, "Okay, so where are you from?" They said, "Baton Rouge." I said, "LSU." They said, "Absolutely." I said, "You got football tickets for me?" They said, "Yes." I said, "You're in."
So, I like your vetting process.
and I've been to LSU to two football games last summer. They hosted me for LSU in Alabama. I mean, just amazing. That's the type of group that we have. Yeah. They'll do anything for anyone.
Hey, just while we're on football for just a minute, I will mention that your loyalty lies with a Pac-12 school, USC. University of Southern California.
Right.
And I'm going to give Art's email address at the end of the show, so stay tuned. But I want you to email him if you're a USC fan, and maybe you can just put in the subject line, "Go Trojans." And then furthermore, if you're not a UCLA or a USC fan, I also want you to email him and razz him a little bit. I'm an Oregon guy, so I would be one of the guys that would razz you a little bit. But would you mind if you get a little playful razzing in your email box?
Well, considering that our football team went 5-7 this year, we deserve razzing.
Yeah, but there's been better times in the past. There'll be better times in the future for SC.
We're hoping.
No doubt. Well, hey, one more comment I want to share with our listeners is that I want to explain to our listeners how highly I regard you, Art. When I bought my practice in May of 07 with Dr. Paul Nielsen, you were the very first person I called. So literally the transaction closed. I think it was about a four o'clock in the afternoon on a Friday afternoon. And Paul and I were now the owners of a dental practice. And I called you. And I called you specifically to tell you that I had bought a practice. And of course, you were very congratulatory. But the real reason I called is I said, "Art, we want to have a great accounting firm as part of our advisory team. And I'm wondering if you might be able to recommend an accounting firm that can help us with our accounting." And you referred us to Owens and Bondell, one of your members here, an ADCPA member in Arizona. And we worked with them ever since. So you were that first person I called.
I do remember that, and the Owens boys and Matt Bondell are just—they're just wonderful, wonderful people. And I knew that you were going to be in good hands with them.
Yeah, and we have. Well, let's talk about the keys to financial independence. And I want to start with you have developed or coined actually a very cool guideline, and you call it the 65-25-10 rule, 65-25-10. And I suspect that's going to be new to our listeners. So would you share the 65-25-10 rule?
I'd be happy to, Gary. So one of the first things when I'm talking to people about keeping track of their finances, one of the things I always say is everything in my life is a math problem. And it is. It's all a math problem. So when I talk to dentists about their financial planning, I say, let's talk about, you know, the first area of financial planning is debt management and income management. How do we spend our money? You make money in a dental practice. Say you make, let's pull a number out of the air. Let's say you make $200,000 a year in your dental practice. What I tell people is, let's use my 65-25-10 rule, which means 65% of that, which would be $130,000, you would use to live on, to pay your house payment, to pay your, pay for food, pay for your living expenses, pay for your family expenses. About 25% of that would go to pay taxes. Now, I know you might have some listeners say, well, I pay more than 25% in taxes. And I go, well, you know, it really depends. We have listeners who give a lot of money to charity, and charity is a very personal thing. I only talk about it in respect of how much it saves you in taxes. We got other people that don't have a mortgage, which we always like. So we have others that have a lot of home mortgage interest, so they might pay less in taxes. So 25%, give or take, of your income goes to pay taxes. And I suspect, Gary, you probably figure out that the other 10%, we would like to have them save. Unfortunately, many of my clients have created a different rule. It's called the 90-25-15 rule. And let me tell you how that one works. They spend 90% of what they make. They still have to pay the 25% in taxes, and we have to work out installment payments with the IRS and the state every year. And the other 15% goes, they have to borrow. And that's part of what I'm sure we'll talk about today. But the 65-25-10 rule is a really, really good thing that I use, and I start off with dentists all the time.
And Art, you've had the pleasure, and I imagine tremendous satisfaction in working with dentists over their career, and you have seen dentists successfully retire through the proper adoption of these principles. And I imagine that that's some of the most joyful work that you get to do.
It really is, and it's very cool. I have actually, because we also sell dental practices in our business here in Southern California, I've actually had three scenarios in the past 2 years where I actually helped the dentist buy their practice 20 to 30 years ago, and then I helped them sell it, and we've been working with them along the way to help them, you know, create the retirement plan and save money. And that is the first thing I ask people, and is, you know, do you have enough money to retire? And, you know, some of them say yes, some of them say no. I'll give you an example, Gary. I had a dentist. This is a sad story. He calls me up. He says, well, I heard you sell dental practices. And I said, yeah, my financial planner says I have to sell my dental practice because, the market's it's going down. And I said, okay. And I did a little exploration. And I said, so doctor, how old are you? I said, he says 66. And I said, well, okay, so let's talk about what you have. What assets do you have? Well, I have a house. Well, what's your house worth? Well, it's worth $1 million. How much do you owe on it? Well, I don't really know. Okay, what's your mortgage payment? $4,000 a month. I said, you owe a lot on your house. Okay. And then I said, how much money have you saved? $100,000. I said, doctor, whoever's giving you advice to sell your practice is giving you bad advice because you'll be bankrupt in 3 years. And he didn't like how that sounded. And on the other hand, we have a number of really great success stories. Gary, one of my dear, dear friends and clients who's a specialist, he just retired, and he's got, you know, well over $3.5 million in his retirement plan, and he's got some real estate, and he owned his dental building, which I think is also a big and important part of your retirement plan. If you can own your dental office building, not only is it a great way to build wealth, but it's also a great way to have income after you retire. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, that's we've been fortunate that a lot of our clients are funding their retirement plans on a monthly basis. It's just a matter of where they are in life too. It's like, if you've got somebody who's in their, you know, in their 30s or 40s and they're raising their children, and then they get into their 40s and 50s and they put their kids through college, and I'm the king of college for them, it's not fun. but it's expensive, and life is expensive. So, but yeah, we've had a lot of great success stories, and it's a wonderful thing to see a doctor, and he can say, you know, Art, I'm ready to retire. I've got enough money, and I can do this.
Right. Well, hey, let's address that 5,000 pound pink elephant in the room, which is debt. And I know you have some great thoughts and concepts around debt. Let's talk a little bit about debt.
Oh, yeah. Debt is the devil. I don't know how to say it any other way, Gary. When young people go to college, on the college campuses, they have these, the Parents' Day or the first day or the first week you go to university. And on the campuses are all the credit card companies, and they're giving you gifts, and they're giving you towels, and they're giving you this and that, because they want you to have their credit cards. The average person under the age of 30, I believe the last thing I read, has somewhere in the neighborhood of 6 to 10 credit cards. And the average person under the age of 40 has anywhere between $15,000 and $40,000 of credit card debt. Mm. And the credit card, I never understood, Gary, why interest rates to buy a house were 4%, 5%, but credit card interest rates were anywhere between, 12 and 25, 30%. I said, I never understood, but now I do, because, people file bankruptcy and they don't pay their credit cards. And what happens is people, I've got, unfortunately, clients who have $100,000, $200,000 of credit card debt. They get 5 or 6 or 7 credit cards, and they're making minimum payments. Mm. And when you make minimum payments on a credit card, in many cases, your debt goes up. And the Visa, MasterCard, Microsoft, they love that, because they're making money on interest every single month. And then you can never dig out. And my dentist, I don't understand, well, where's all my money going? You say I'm making all this profit. Well, doctor, you spent $100,000 or $200,000 on all this stuff, and now you have to pay it off. And we deducted it back then. So I have credit cards that have to be paid off every month. I'd cut my left arm off, Gary, before I would run up credit card debt. I think that doctors need to get a limit on their credit card, maybe $5,000 or $10,000 a month or whatever they need, and whatever they're comfortable to pay it off. And they don't, you get into it. It's like a drug, unfortunately. I mean, it's easy, because you just hand the vendor that little plastic card, and I don't have to give them any money today.
Right.
So I want to encourage your listeners to, if they don't have a plan, if they're in credit card debt and they don't have a plan to get out of it, sit down with a financial planner, somebody from the ADCPA, and put a plan together to get out of debt, because credit card debt is the downfall of many of my folks who have financial difficulties.
Oh, absolutely. Hey, I want to get real granular within this, because it ties back into debt. And I imagine you get this question. We have listeners literally from the entire spectrum in dentistry, all the way from pre-dent, that listeners listen to this even before they're in dental school, all the way to, senior practitioners. My favorite email is one that I got recently from an 88-year-old listener, which was kind of cool. But the question is, and I want you to share this, for especially for our younger listeners, that this question is probably top of mind, and that is, Art, should I buy a house first or buy a practice first?
That's a great question, Gary. You talked about clients and listeners. I actually put on a marketing seminar about 2 years ago, and we had a 94-year-old dentist come to the marketing seminar. He wanted to market his practice.
God, I love how cool that is, because he has a mindset of being vital and active and useful and productive. I love that, Art.
he just retired at the age of 95 and a half. God bless him. He was a Holocaust survivor and just a wonderful, wonderful. We don't have too many of those. But
you know what's ironic, Art? We won't use his name, but I actually know who that is, because he came to one of my courses that we gave at the Old Ranch Country Club in Long Beach. And I know the story, because he's a Holocaust survivor. He sat in my course. I believe that he was maybe 90 at that time. And he never stopped taking notes. He took them analog with a you know, a pen and paper, and he had 10 or 12 pages of notes from my 3-hour course. And what a delightful example of abundance thinking and gratitude and a life well lived, huh?
Oh, absolutely. And his dental team loved him.
He was surrounded by his dental team, and he never stopped smiling the entire time, and they absolutely loved him and he loved them. And it was just, it was very inspirational. Absolutely.
No, you're absolutely right. So back to your question about, should I buy a house or should I buy a practice? I am of the opinion you buy the practice first. And here's why. The practice is going to give you the financial ability to buy the house. You know, you go out, you buy a house. Now, you know, in my town, there's usually, unfortunately, a one in front of a house, like $1 million. The houses here are very expensive. Northern California is even worse. If I own a practice, I have the ability to build that practice. I have the ability to do all kinds of things. And I think that gives me the financial ability, because what if you buy a house, you've got a job, maybe you're working in one of the large group practices that are out there, and you lose your job or something happens and now you have this big mortgage. Whereas if you have a practice, you control your own destiny. And Gary, you and I are so soulmates as far as entrepreneurship and the private fee-for-service practice of dentistry.
Can I just state it in simple terms? And doctors, as you're listening to this, it's my opinion, and I believe Art's, although I'll let him speak for himself on this, that while there are many great career paths in dentistry, and literally, I don't think there's a bad career path in dentistry. In my opinion, there's nothing like owning your own practice, and there's nothing like entrepreneurship in dentistry. And I suspect that you're going to feel the same way, Art.
Oh no. I will tell you that. I will tell you at our ADCPA meetings, we meet twice a year. We talk about entrepreneurship. We talk about that. And what's interesting, Gary, is when I sell and close a dental practice sale, I will address the seller and I'll say to the seller, listen, doctor, I want you to think back on the 35 or 40 years of your career and the thousands of people that you have changed lives for. And they get the big smile. And then I will look at the buyer, who's probably anywhere between 30 and 40 years old, and I'll say, Dr. Smith, I just want you to promise me that you are going to continue the private practice of dentistry and deliver world-class care to your patients, and do not succumb to the temptations of insurance companies and other things that you can do that would discount what you do. And so I'm absolutely adamant about that, because our profession, I say our profession, I've embraced it 34 years and working with dentists. I love dentists. I think they are the most wonderful, caring people. I've had opportunities to refer patients to people in the local area, and I see how they treat their patients. And it's just amazing.
It's a very precious obligation and opportunity that dentists have to serve people. And my hat goes off to them. Hey, Art, can I share? I suspected that your answer was going to be by the practice first, but can I share an example of something that happened in my client life about that very question?
It's your show, Gary. You can do whatever you want.
So, hey, this goes back a number of years ago, but a client of mine decided that it was time for a new office. His old office was dingy. He had bought this practice, and it was in a mid-sized town, and the facility had been neglected by the previous dentist. It was neglected over the last 20, 25 years. It wasn't upgraded. My client bought the practice, and it was a very good practice to buy in terms of the numbers and opportunity, but the facility was in need of some work. So I had to kind of encourage him to slow down a little bit of that. So I didn't want him to make too many changes all at once. You know, with regard to the patients had been coming there for years, and he wanted to come in and make some wholesale changes in the facility. I said, no, just wait a little bit. It's already a big change, them seeing a new dentist. Be patient with it. We'll make the changes in due time. And after about a year, we decided it was time. He had a very successful situation where he kept most of the patients in the practice. Only a handful went away. And I said, now it's time. And so he worked with a dental architect and a designer and completely remodeled that office to represent what was then state of the art, you know, without being over the top. It was nice without being over the top. Art, when I describe that, I imagine you can get a mental image of what that looks like, right?
Of course.
Yeah, very nice, but you know, no silk wallpaper, no chandeliers, you know, no imported Italian marble. You know, it was
waterfalls.
No waterfalls. Yeah, right. So anyway, his wife had said at that time, "Hey, let's host an open house. Let's do an open house and invite all the patients to come in from the open house. It'll be a fun way to let everyone see, you know, what the new remodeled office looks like." And we said, yeah, she approached me about it. I said, I think that's a great idea because otherwise they'll trickle in over the next 6-8 months. And it's kind of good to do an open house, invite all your patients in. So anyway, we do the open house. It was in late afternoon, early evening, like 4 to 7, had some light snacks and literally hundreds of patients came over that 4 to 7 o'clock hour. And I remember I was there and I remember a particular interaction with a patient, an older patient of his, in his 70s. And this guy was well known in town. He was a rancher. And hard, you know, working man and wonderful patient, by the way. But he pulled the doctor aside and he said, "Doctor, this office is beautiful." He said, I love the colors and the materials and everything that you've done. Wow, you've done a great job." And the doctor modestly said, "Yeah, I had some help. I couldn't match my socks in the morning. So I worked with a designer and a dental architect to help us do this. But, you know, thank you for the comment." And then the patient said, "Now, I bet you live in a fancy house too." And the dentist said, "No, as a matter of fact, I still live in the same apartment that I lived. It's over on Elm Street. I live in the same apartment that I first moved into when I moved to town." And the patient smiled, reached out his hand, and he said, "Attaboy, build the barn first."
No, that's a great story. And Gary, that brings to mind the book, The Millionaire Next Door.
Right.
I mean, for all of your listeners who are, well, for any of your listeners, but particularly for your listeners that are younger, The Millionaire Next Door is a book about someone who lives very frugally and who doesn't have a huge house. But the reason that he's a millionaire is because he lives frugally. I made my boys read that book and they said, "Dad, now I think I understand what you've been talking about."
It'll pay dividends for their life. The cool part about, of course, that was the gosh honest truth. He really did live. He and his wife, they didn't have children at that time. They lived in the apartment that they moved into when they first moved to town. And you should have seen the smile on the rancher's face when he reached out and shook his hand. He said, "Attaboy, build the barn first." This guy became one of the best referral sources in that practice for many, many years. And he just got it. He got the concept. You know, if any of you know anything about farming or ranching, the barn is what you build first, because that's the goose that lays the golden egg, right?
Exactly. And it comes back to your initial question, Gary, is do you buy the practice first? That's the goose,
right?
You know, and that's what we want them to do first. And the house will come and the car will come and this will come and that will come.
Yeah, you're right. Hey, so let's move to maybe a later part of, or what will happen later in their career, which is retirement. But retirement isn't just something you hit the finish line. You got to plan for it. Would you talk a little bit about some concepts related to retirement planning and maybe even when our dentist should start investing in retirement planning? Again, I know those answers because you've been very influential in my thinking on this, but I want our listeners to hear.
Well, first of all, I want to make the point, and I did on my podcast a couple 2-3 weeks ago, Art's Golden Rules. And one of those golden rules is get in the habit of saving money, and get in the habit of saving money early, because folks, it doesn't go bad. It's not like a piece of fruit. If I put it in the crisper and it lays there for 3 weeks and it goes rotten. No, money doesn't go bad. In fact, it grows, and compound interest is incredible. And the younger that you can start saving money, even if it's, you know, even if it's $10 a week, and I know that people out there are going to be thinking, "Oh my gosh, Art, I've got student loan debt payments, $3,000-$4,000 a month. I've got rent. I've got car. I've got this. I've got to support an elderly parent. Who knows?
I can't. But, you know, the mental construct is I can't afford to invest in retirement. And I would add one word to that: you can't afford not to invest in retirement. And before you continue with that, I do want to make one quick comment. As a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, I can assure you that you will absolutely love Art's podcast. It's called The Art of Dental Finance. Hit pause right now. You're likely listening to this on your phone. Hit pause. Go to your phone and search for, under iTunes, search for The Art of Dental Finance and hit subscribe. And Art, I think you've got about a dozen or so episodes up now.
Yeah, we've had we're about 3 months into it. We publish every week. Thank you. You're so kind to do that.
Well, this one needs to be in your listening rotation. If you're a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, I can assure you you'll appreciate Art's podcast. Put it in your listening rotation. Subscribe to it so you get it every time he publishes a new show. You'll get to that, and you will be very grateful for the counsel and the wisdom that Art shares with you.
Well, you're very kind, Gary. You were my inspiration to get into podcasting, and you've got the premier podcast. And also, I'm sure your listeners not only are listening to this one, but also the one you're doing on insurance dependence or getting away from insurance dependence. So as far as retirement planning is, I always tell doctors 3 to 5 years before you think you want to pull the trigger, you need to kind of start putting the wheels in place. So what does that mean? That means, number one, you want to make sure that you have, your facility is in good shape. Digital X-ray is critical for a dentist to buy a practice because the dentists today, Gary, they don't know how to practice without it. It's their standard of care. So a dentist that goes to buy a practice without digital X-ray, they're thinking, oh my gosh, I've got to put $50,000 in my budget or more to buy a digital X-ray. Mm-hmm. Number two, you got to sit down with your CPA and your financial planner, and you've got to make sure that you're on track to have enough money to retire. Now, the rule of thumb, Gary, is you take your retirement nest egg. Let's say that we have a dentist who's been fortunate enough to accumulate, you know, $3 million, and that's a nice nest egg. So that $3 million, the rule of thumb that we financial planners use is 4 to 5% of that is what you can draw on an annual basis. So doctors, if you're ready to retire and you've got $3 million, you can plan on drawing maybe somewhere between $120,000 and $150,000 a year. If you're 65 or 66 years old, maybe you and your spouse will be able to draw Social Security. And then you say, okay, Can I live on that amount of money? If I can, then yeah, I can put the wheels in motion. But you got to do a plan and figure out, am I going to be able to do this? The other thing, doctors, that we have to remember, the other thing, Gary, that we have to remember for our doctors, is that, and Gary promised me that there's nobody from the IRS is on the other line listening to this.
Nope. We're good.
Okay, I want to make sure because one day, I mean, I do lectures. I don't lecture as much as you do, but I do a good number of lectures every year. I always tell people that they're going to take me away in handcuffs one day. Doctors, you sometimes accidentally stuff goes through your practice. We call them business expense. I had a client up in north of Los Angeles who coined that for me. Well, Art, I have a bunch of business expenses. I said, what does that mean? He said, well, it's a combination of business and personal. They're business, right? and so the business expenses are the travel, the stuff that, you know, Costco and Home Depot and stuff like that. And you got to remember, Gary, that when you sell your practice, there's no more practice to pay for all that. So if you need $120,000 or $150,000 a year, you probably got to add another $20,000 to $40,000 a year, maybe, to pay for all that. So we got to be ready financially. We've also got to be ready mentally. And I've had doctors, Gary, that they are just, they've told me, several of them, I've been a dentist for 40 years. I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm scared.
This is such an important topic, Art, because I have like you, you and I are similar age and similar progression in our careers. And I've also had the privilege of working with many dentists that have, you know, hit the finish line professionally in their career. And one thing I've noticed, Art, is, you know, I've kind of made it a fun study to study how dentists retire. And I've noticed that it's kind of black or white. It's not really gray. And what I mean by that is that some dentists have a really joyful retirement and others don't. What I notice is there seems to be one common denominator in dentists that have a joyful retirement, and that is they have something to retire to, not just retiring away from something. Does that make sense, Art?
Oh, that makes so much sense, Gary, because here's what I tell doctors to do. I say, I want you to sit in a room and I want you to think about this. And I was at our ADCPA meeting in Boston, and I happen to have a client that's in the state of Maine, and we agreed we were going to meet halfway. So I spent a half of a day walking around a wonderful town called Portsmouth, New Hampshire.
Yes.
I'd never been there. And I'm walking by, walking around, and it was a little rainy, and I had a couple hours just to walk around and be by myself and be with my thoughts. And I saw a little storefront with a little, like, accordion thing on the ground. And you know what it said, Gary? It said, do things that make you happy. And I took a picture of that, and I posted it on my Instagram page. And I literally changed my life, because now I literally look at something, I go, if I'm doing this, does this make me happy? And, you know, the fact of the matter is that's what people have to think about. And the other thing I'll tell doctors is that they should, you know, we've got the dental conventions coming up. I mean, the Chicago Midwinter is in February. The CDA is coming up in May. And I say to doctors who are 3 to 5 years out, doctors, don't go to the convention and look for impression material. Okay? Don't look for impression material. In fact, it was funny, 10 years ago when I hosted the ADCPA meeting, or 12 years ago, we had your good friend and my good friend David Hornbrook on.
Yeah.
And I asked David, I said, David, he spoke to our group. I said, what's going to be different in 10 or 15 years? He said, there will be no impression material in 10 or 15 years. Now we're not quite there yet, but we're moving that way.
We're close.
Yeah. So, you know, do what makes you happy and go to the dental convention and walk around the booths and say, huh, is there anything in the dental profession that I might be able to do that doesn't involve wet finger dentistry? You could become a consultant. You might want to go into sales. You might want to maybe do some work for one of the insurance companies. I don't know, but there's all kinds of different jobs. We have doctors that have gone into consulting. That's one thing to think about, but do what it is that you're passionate about, because as you and I both know, Gary, dentistry is a very physically demanding career. And one of the other reasons to fund money for retirement is because you don't want to wake up one day and say, I can't do this anymore. I've had about 2 to 3 out of 10 of the practices that we transition are because a doctor either has back, neck, shoulder, which is why ergonomics are so important. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, God forbid, you know, cancer and illness and what have you. So you want to be thinking about what is it that you want to do? And I will tell you, a very personal story. My mom was an accountant. I always tell the story that my mother and grandmother, my Jewish mother and my Jewish grandmother from Brooklyn, my mother had a bachelor's in guilt and my grandmother had a master's. That's exactly what they had. And my mom became an accountant, and all she could do is talk about her two boys, me and my wonderful brother, Michael. And she I helped her sell her accounting practice. She was 82. She retired April 15th. She didn't do anything, and she died in the middle of August, because you need to stay active. You absolutely need to stay active, whatever it is.
And that's my point about having something to retire to rather than just retiring from. And Art, let's also recognize it that to be successful as a dentist requires a certain level of intensity and immersion in your profession. And that's good on one hand, and yet it also can be very one-dimensional for some. But I've noticed that when dentists retire and retire successfully and enjoy their retirement, they have other hobbies and interests. It might be photography. It might be travel. It could be family. You know, it could be time to spend time with the kids and grandkids. And but I notice those that have something to retire to are more emotionally prepared for it. Not only retirement's not just a financial construct, but it's an emotional construct as well. And another thought is there are ways to stay involved in the profession that make a lot of sense. For example, if you plan this ahead of time, and I want to really echo Art's comments about planning for this ahead of time, perhaps when you sell your practice, you go back to work for the purchasing dentist under the plan on a part-time basis. Maybe you work 2 or 3 days a week, and maybe you extend your career by choice, a handful of years because you now work part-time. I can tell you from having many dentists in our client base that have successfully retired, those years can be the most enjoyable in their life, working 2 or 2.5 or 3 days a week. And again, this has to be under the agreement of the purchaser as well. And in some situations, this makes sense for, and some it does not. But that's something to explore. And the other thing, and this isn't so much on the financial side, but there may be wonderful ways for you to contribute in terms of volunteer work and charity work. Perhaps it's with the MOM program, the Mission of Mercy program, or, you know, it's likely your state association has some program where you can be involved in some charity care to help those in need that don't receive care. And that can be a wonderful way to use all this wealth of experience that you have for the better good. It's not going to line your bank account, but it's going to align your emotional bank account. And Art, before we leave this topic of retirement, can you give our listeners a Reader's Digest condensed version of, I've heard you talk about 3 different retirement plans. I know there are actually many more than that, but there's 3 that tend to fit most dentists. Can you give a quick Reader's Digest summary of those 3 different pension plan environments?
I can, Gary. So basically, I call them baby bear, mama bear, and papa bear. So for the doctor, and it's very simple. It really, again, remember I said earlier, Gary, my life is a math problem. Well, this is a math problem. How much money can you afford to save every year? So for the doctor that's starting out, that can afford to save anywhere between zero and $30,000, $35,000 a year, you want to look at what's called a simple IRA. And it's simple. You can go down to any bank or brokerage and set it up. There's no IRS filing requirements. And you can put away a deferral of up to, you know, it's $13,000 a year. Plus you can match 3%. It's very simple. And that's and you can put your spouse on the payroll. And that's the simple IRA. That's for someone starting out. It's the first retirement plan. Maybe they're not doing just a regular IRA where they're putting away, you know, $6,000 a year. So the first is a simple IRA. Then, you know, maybe we paid off the practice loan. Maybe they hired a Gary Takis who came in and just absolutely helped them take their practice through the roof, which I've seen Gary do, my gosh, for years and years and years. His practices just do amazing. And so Gary, we have this doctor, and now maybe they paid off a loan. Now we go to the mama bear plan, which is called a profit sharing plan with a 401k component. And doctors under the age of 50 can put away about $56,000 a year. They can put their spouses on the payroll. If they're under 50, they can put away about $19,000. So $75,000 a year, plus we put away for employees. So for the doctors that can put away, you know, $50,000 to $90,000 a year, the profit sharing plan. And then we have the Papa Bear plan, which is really cool. And we use that for doctors who are getting ready for retirement. And that's called a defined benefit pension plan. And for doctors who are older than actually 35 to 40 years old, they can start funding this plan. And the defined contribution, which is the profit sharing of the simple, is based on a percentage of your income, very much simplifying it. The defined benefit says, okay, Gary, I'm 55 years old. How much money actuarially do I have to put into a plan to have about $180,000 a year available to me to retire over the rest of my life? Well, if you start when you're 25, you can't put a lot in. But if you start when you're 50 or 55, I have doctors that are putting a ton of money away. Let me give you an example. So I have a specialist that we've been planning his retirement. He had the person who was going to take over. We had them contractually tied in for 3 years, that 3 years from now, they were going to buy the practice. So we set up a defined benefit plan. Year one, we put away $155,000. Year two, we put away $155,000. Year three, we put away the same, $155,000. Year four, boom, we sold the practice, got about $800,000 for it, and we put about $380,000 into the defined benefit plan. So we deferred the gain on the sale of the practice and put a nice nest egg for retirement. And if you plan it 3 or 4 years out, you can save the taxes, a good amount of the taxes. Now, remember, you're not saving them permanently. They're being deferred to when you take them out. But that's the, so those are the three types of pension plans. And I mean, if we can get somebody in their 50s doing a defined benefit plan, my gosh, I'm just like happier than a clam.
Art, as you described that Papa Bear plan, that defined benefit pension plan, I think this analogy will make sense for any of the golfers in our listener base, of which Art and I are one. We've had the privilege of sharing some time on the golf course together. It's kind of like hitting a drive, that Papa Bear. It's kind of like hitting a drive with about a 50-mile-an-hour tailwind.
Yeah, right? It really is. And it's, I mean, it can really get you to your goal pretty fast if you can afford to do it. But again, here's another example of what we've done, Gary. So I have a wonderful doctor in the Los Angeles area, and he's starting his life. He's got two young children, just had a second kid. And what he did, we came to the fact that he's going to pay off his 10-year practice loan in, I think it's May or June of this year. So I said, how much, I looked it up. I said, that's $6,000 a month. He says, so Art, what am I going to do with that money? I said, you're going to write the same check, the same $6,000, except instead of writing it to the bank, you're going to write it to your pension fund. So we're going to put he and his wife on, set up the profit sharing plan with a 401k component. He's going to add a little bit more money to it, and he's going to be saving, instead of writing that check, $72,000 a year to the bank. He's going to be writing that $72,000 to his retirement fund. And, he's 38 or 39. Great, great guy. I love this guy. And his practice is booming. We're trying to get him into a new facility. I mean, just all the really things that get you and I really excited about a doctor who's got a passion for this. And he says, Art, this is great. And I said, if we put away, $75,000 a year for 20 years, and it doesn't grow one dime, which we know isn't going to happen, that's $1.5 million.
Just on the contributions, let alone the...
Just on the contributions.
Yeah. Well, what a simple but brilliant format there. He was used to paying that $6,000 a month payment. He just keeps doing it. And now, instead of increasing spending or getting crazy with it, he allocates it to his retirement and just going to give him that much more resources down the road.
Exactly.
Well, as a listener now, you know why I wanted to have Art on the show, and I wanted Art to talk about the keys to financial independence. Art, would you be kind enough to share the website address for the accounting firm, your former accounting firm, and now they have succeeded you and you remain as an advisor on the firm? They're, of course, a member of the ADCPA. Would you be kind enough to share that website address? And I'll put it in the show notes, so don't, if you're driving, don't take your hands off the wheel, but I'll put this in the show notes.
Sure. And Gary, I am a partner in the firm, and I'm in helping run the dental division. So I'm in no way, shape, or form retiring. I love what I do. The website is www.hmwccpa.com. And in fact, if you go onto our website, all of our podcasts are on the website. So you do the hmwccpa.com/podcast, and that'll link you to all the different ones that we've published.
And they're all available. They're all available in the archive.
Yes.
Those again need to be in your listener rotation. And Art, for the USC fans, and let's call them the USC and the others, of which I'm one of the others.
Yes,
would you be kind enough to share your email address so we can either celebrate with you as a fellow USC fan, or we can rib you a little bit if we have other loyalties?
Okay. All right. I'll let you do that. It's Art, A-R-T dot or period, Wiederman, and that's Wiederman at hmwc.com. And make it W-I-E because the state of New York, when I was born, spelled my birth certificate wrong. They spelled it E-I. And a lot of people spell it EI, but it's Wiederman.
And is it is it at hmwccpa.com?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
It absolutely
so
is.
I'll put that in the show notes. So again, it's Art, A-R-T dot Wiederman, Wiederman at hmwccpa.com. And I'm quite serious about this. If you're a fellow Trojan, of which Art is one of the leading advocates, be sure to write Go Trojan in the subject line.
And you understand, Gary, that all my UCLA clients are now going to leave my accounting firm after this. But what can I tell you?
That's right. And hey, if you have other football loyalties, let Art know about it in the email. And he's a good-natured fellow, so he will take that ribbon quite well. Hey, Art, I want to take a minute and say thanks, man. You've been a dear friend and colleague for many, many, many years. I count my life enhanced through knowing you as a friend, and I'm a smarter guy from working with you and from learning from you and having you serve as a mentor. So, Art, man, thanks for all that you do.
Yeah, Gary, I want to just say one more thing, and I want to give this right back to you. You are an icon in dentistry, not only in the United States, but around the world. You have been an inspiration to me. And folks, one of the things that Gary did, he's on the board of the ADCPA, and he spoke at our meeting in Huntington Beach, and he talked about legacy. And he did a fantastic video. What was the rock band that was the video?
It was Led Zeppelin. And it was
Stairway to Heaven.
Stairway to Heaven. It was an epic performance of Stairway to Heaven that I used as a way to talk about the topic of legacy. And that was a fun present. It was your meeting. You hosted it there in Huntington Beach, and you were kind enough to invite me to come and speak. And I talked a little bit about legacy for your members and how they can introduce legacy to their dental clients, and that was fun.
Well, at the end of the day, Gary, what you have done for the dental profession with all the consulting you've done, all the talks you've done, the lectures you've done, your unbelievable podcast, I mean, that's your legacy. Your legacy is you have helped dentists have better enjoyment of their practice and be better, you know, financially and things like that. And kudos to you. And I consider you one of my dear friends, and I love talking to you. I love golfing with you. You and I golfed right before. Remember, we golfed right before the Phoenix Open. So what we did is we snuck on to the 16th hole, and I think I hadn't taken lessons before that, so I think I killed two people with my slice.
That was an epic day that will be. I will forever remember that.
It was so much fun
for those listeners that may not be aware of that. The Phoenix Open is held at the TPC. Golf club here in Scottsdale, and the 16th hole, they literally line the entire hole with bleachers and skyboxes, and it's now three stories tall. Art, I believe it actually seats around 30,000 people. It literally becomes a stadium. It's the only golf hole like that on the entire tour. Well, you and I were playing a couple weeks before the tournament, and so we snuck over there and actually played the 16th hole, simulated, of course, because there weren't 40,000 fans, you know, in the audience. But we got to experience it like the pros did, and that will forever go down in my memory as maybe one of my favorite golf holes I've ever played. That was fun.
There is no other like it. So,
yeah. Well, hey, I also want to take a minute and thank our listeners, man. We appreciate each and every one of you here on the Thriving Dentist Show. There's three things you can do to support our work. Number one, you can tell a colleague about it. So tell a friend about the Thriving Dentist Show. Also tell them about the Art of Dental Finance, Art's podcast. Second thing you can do is you can jump on iTunes and write us a review. A review on iTunes will help dentists find us when they're searching for information. They're searching for podcasts. So if you haven't done it, jump on iTunes and write a review, and do the same for Art, if you would, on his Art of Dental Finance podcast. And third thing you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. You can do that on iTunes, or you can do that on Google Play. It's free. It's or whatever directory, dental podcast directory of choice you use. There's always a subscribe button. Hit subscribe. And that means every time we publish a new episode, you'll never miss one. On that note, let me simply say thank you for the privilege of your time, and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. When you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.